Hello, my name is Clownbear. Yes, that is my name. Welcome to a series I'd like to call Clownbear Conquers, and for the next few videos, I'll be conquering Live2D with you. Not really conquering per se, it's just for alliteration. But first, let us tackle some questions.
What are programs going to use for Live2D?
Any program that can export to PSD is enough. If you want to be sure your program counts, look it up online.
Can you only make VTubers in Live2D?
No. Think of it as an animation program like Adobe Animate or Spine. People have been using it to animate stuff like game models and some even make full-fledged animations. The little intro this video has is animated in Live2D animation mode, and I've made a few other animations as well. Here's my earliest attempt at using Live2D. It took under 30 hours over a span of a week. And even then, I want to reduce in parts. This portion of the video isn't really part of the tutorial. I think it's just effective to show video processes of people separating the parts or having a sample PSD file itself. Speaking of, you can go check Deep Blizzard's Live2D sample file. You can download it for free in booth.pm and I'll link it down below. Make sure you read these terms of use though. Okay. If you have your PSD ready, you can skip to here. For now, I'll just list some tips for illustrating the models. Tip 1. For the canvas size, start with a canvas 4096x4096 big. This is so your texture atlas won't compromise the textures as much. Tip 2. Use a symmetry ruler and make sure your drawing is as close to the middle as possible, even if it's not symmetrical. Not necessary, but I will recommend sketching an A pose first, then erasing and modifying some parts to make it asymmetrical. Even if your model isn't supposed to face front by default, it's easier to make a front-facing model turn 3/4 than vice versa. I've been combining techniques draw as you cut and cut after the drawing. I just made those up. Here's what either method can be good for. Both have its own merits. Tip number 3. Put your face layer shading on a different layer so you can clip it onto the eyelids and the mouth. Tip number 4. As a general rule of thumb, if you want a part to move independently, draw it on a new layer. This counts for stuff like shadows and eye highlights. Tip number 5. One thing you can do is draw both symmetrical parts in one folder, for example, eyes, afterwards, while making sure symmetry is off so it won't reflect. Select one eye in the master folder with the lasso tool, cut, paste, and rename everything. And once you're done, let's head to the Live2D proper. To import your model, just drop your PSD file directly onto the canvas. You can rearrange your workspace to your liking. Personally, I prefer to make a part tab and deformer tab long. You've probably done it already, but if you haven't, delete the background of your file. When you import to Live2D, all your clipping masks will be unclipped like the star print of this hat. To clip them again, copy the target base, then paste it onto the clipping ID section. And yeah, you can put multiple IDs separated with a comma. To change the background color, click the square under the three camera icons. This won't affect the finished product, just something that'll help you see it better. Select all alternate parts that aren't supposed to show up yet, like alternate eyes, hands, etc. And then put the opacity all the way down to 0, so they won't show up at default. Okay, save your work from time to time. Now for draw order, I didn't really do it for this model because it's way too simple, but this is a helpful tool if your model is too complicated and you want a part from one folder to appear under the one below it in the hierarchy. Draw order is basically what layer is closer to the viewer. Higher draw order means it'll be on top of parts with the lower draw order, regardless of which folder it's in. You can check by dragging while holding E, then dragging while holding W. You can reset by holding either letter and double clicking. The range is from 1000 to 0, and I recommend you setting increments by 10 or 20. or 100. You can also change the draw order by assigning it parameters. Now, make sure all the important parts are selected. Go to Automatic Mesh Generator, then select Standard. Don't worry, we'll redo the ones we don't like down the line. This is just for the next step. Select the Texture Atlas button. On the free version, not free trial, is limited to 2048 by 2048. This is enough for some half-body models, otherwise it'll ultimately make your model blurry. You can change this when you upgrade to the pro version. It's better to downscale a big model than to upscale a small one. The ideal size is 4096 by 4096. Larger ones might make your PC struggle. You can make more smaller textures if they don't all fit on the pro version. You can't do that on the free version. Just to make it clear, the free trial, the 40-day one, is for the pro version. It's not the same as the free version. Okay, click on the biggest part and make sure it's on the 90 to 100% range. If it's lower than that, it might appear blurry up close, and if you're okay with that, that's fine. But for me, what I do is delete some of the parts, select the remaining ones, and re-layout them with automatic layout. Then, make a new texture atlas, not available in the free version, and put them all big boys there. You may have to manually lay out some of them, because AI is stupid. Then press OK and save. Save! Don't forget to do that. You did things correctly if you zoom in and don't see blurriness. At the end of your project, open up the texture atlas and press OK again, just in case. This is optional, but something I'd recommend you doing. Make a new folder where you put all your deformers. That way you can easily locate and rearrange them. To put a part inside of the deformer, you can do it two ways. First is to select all the parts, click the deformer icon, and add its parent to selected object. Make sure the destination part is the deformer folder you just made. Second is to just drag it onto an existing deformer, and it'll automatically create a thread. Your deformer should cover the entire part that's inside it. Hold Ctrl if you want to adjust the size without distorting the part. Hold Alt if you want the opposite side to adjust at the same time. And Shift is to move it in a straight line. Okay, the first time I ever did this, it took me a very long time. And this new one is too simple, so there's fewer deformers. So, I'll just pose a deformer hierarchy you can use as a guide while I speed up organizing them. Of course, you can customize the guide to your liking, but this is the general idea. One thing that's important to remember is that the left and the right should be the model's left and right, not yours. Here I'm lowering the opacity of the left eye, because I'm planning to duplicate the right eye and replace it. This is totally optional. I'll expand on that in the next video. Here, I'm organizing the parameters in the folders. This is especially helpful since later down the line, the physics parameters will make it too bulky and crowded. Oh yeah, I don't really need these last three parameters, so I just deleted them. Before we start with the breath parameter, it's important to put the head and all the major limbs into rotation deformers, so they won't distort like this. The head deformer should be inside the neck deformer. Okay, so now what I'm doing here is that I'm duplicating a rough part to put behind the head, so when I turn my head, the back part doesn't look cut off. Here's what each button of the parameter tab does. If they're green, that means they're recording any changes you make. Be mindful of this. Now, let's do the breath parameter. Add two keyframes. 0 should be your default. Slide it over to 1. Right-click snaps it in place. Click the red X, then drag the middle green part upwards a little bit. Make little adjustments with the other green handles, and that's it. You can check it by sliding the parameter with your cursor, or going to the physics tab and making sure breath is checked on the preview. And that's it for today! I hope you found it helpful! Well, I'd like to thank my patrons for making this possible. For the next video, I'll be dedicating the whole thing to blinking. There's a lot to unpack here for those big ol' eyes. It'll be up soon, but for now, check out this other video. Goodbye!